Joining us now on What She Said is Dilys D'Cruz, Vice President and Head of Wealth Management, and Nancie Taylor, Senior Wealth Advisor at Meridian Credit Union. And we're going to be talking about taking the stress and judgment out of meeting with a financial advisor. And Dilys, you actually brought a financial advisor, Nancie.
I brought a real live advisor.
You're always telling us to go meet with our financial advisors.
Yeah.
And the people
and now we have one.
And now, I mean, what's to worry about?
Yeah. So, you know what? I am always saying go see an advisor. And I thought, how perfect is to actually bring in an advisor and one of our top advisors, I must say, to talk about the experience. And we've talked about this a lot, firstly, for women, how important it is for women to take over their financial control of their finances, because at some point in time, they will probably have to do it themselves.
Right.
We also know that women are out earning their spouses regularly, and it's so critical that they go and see someone. But quite often, women are afraid to. They feel, I don't think I have enough, or I don't know enough. I don't want anyone to judge me. And so we want to kind of take that all out of the picture and really kind of talk to Nancie about what does it look like. We want to take the fear, the self-judgment, and the worry about going to see an advisor out of it.
So, Nancie, why do you think women are feeling this way?
I think sometimes there's some shame and maybe disappointment. They're not on track. There's some fear of looking at their plan, but it has to start somewhere. So I believe the more open and honest you are with the planner when you sit down with her, the more that she can kind of peel back the layers and try to determine how best to take you forward. There's, you know, women are very busy. They have a lot on their plate. They're juggling a lot. They're often putting themselves last ahead of all the other loved ones in their lives. So to take an hour and spend it with an advisor to start that process with the fear behind how they look could be a little daunting.
The other thing, too, I'm wondering how much of it is a generational thing. So their mothers were brought up in a sort of society where the father looked after the money, and they see that, and it's not talked about. I mean, it's not an open discussion at the table. We can't afford a holiday this year or whatever, or we're behind in our taxes or whatever it may be. It's sort of behind closed doors, and so that transfers generationally or...
Absolutely.
Or is it just a female characteristic?
Yeah, and I think a couple of things, too, and Nancie and I were talking about this, and we've all talked about it, is even in this generation, as women become more educated, once they get married, they're letting go of their financial, firstly, the financial literacy is dropping. But we did have a conversation about this, is that the literacy and knowledge for women may not be dropping. It's just that men may have a little bit more bravado and confidence about how much they know. And I think, Nancie, you and I talked about this as well in terms of when women and men come in to see you. You know, women actually know a lot more than they think, but, you know, men will probably project out more in terms of what they think they know as well, too. And I think you may have some examples in terms of when women come in to see you. Is there a hesitancy in terms of taking control?
Absolutely. I met with a client last week that, you know, it was our first meeting together, and we were discussing how the husband is the main breadwinner, and she has a career as well, but she's juggling a lot on her plate with her household affairs and the children in sports. But within a half an hour, she had a degree in finance. So she her confidence and her ability wasn't there, but she definitely had the brains for it to be there, you know.
Which is so surprising.
She underestimated herself, right? Yeah.
Do women feel... The amount of money they have to invest, is that a requirement for when you should go and see an advisor?
Absolutely not. You can go see an advisor when you have wealth, but if you go see an advisor as you're accumulating wealth, then that plan could be put in place early so that it provides for you today and down the road. And it all starts with that budget. What does that budget look like? What does your financial situation look like today? And then that's the very first step to then how we provide advice for what we need tomorrow and down the road.
Let me ask you, is the relationship between a man and a financial advisor and a woman and a financial advisor different in that you have to present differently, or you have to appeal to different things to gain a woman's trust? I think women are looking for different things.
Women want definitely a personal connection. Your financial advisor is somebody that is there to support you. And I look at the financial advisor as other people that you hold high up in your lives. So whether it's a spiritual advisor or whether it's a personal trainer, your financial advisor is kind of up there for most women. And if they don't connect with you, it'll be very difficult to take planning to the next level.
So what do you do if you don't connect with that at that first advisor? So I come into Meridian Credit Union, I meet with an advisor, I'm thinking, I don't feel that connection. I would think, I know I would be, as a woman, I wouldn't want to sort of go through the whole office as it was until I found someone. Mm-hmm. Like, how can you avoid that kind of scenario happening?
I would just be very honest, because when it comes to money, it's the one of the most important things. And if you can't connect with the first person you meet with, a financial advisor will not take that personally. They will look
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Important. I'd say, does it matter if they take it for, like,
yeah, there you go.
Right? I mean, it's like when we're scared to change hairdressers in the same salon, right?
No, I know, true. But you're going to place.
Yeah.
So let's say I'm at Meridian and I don't want that person to then have the coworkers. I'm thinking as a woman, what Kate's saying, the coworkers looking at her going, oh, well, that woman didn't like her.
Yeah.
But if I don't find somebody, I'm not going to stay there.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because I really would say that we would all agree, and all the advisors that work at Meridian, but we want the right fit for both. And so I would like to just remove that completely. If it's not the right fit, this is a longer-term relationship we want to establish. Mm-hmm. And to just say, I don't think it's the right fit. Is there someone else I can talk to? And if they're not comfortable to do that, there are other people within the branch, because they may have gotten referred through the branch manager or through someone else.
Exactly.
To say, is there somebody else? And I would say that all our advisors would be totally okay with that. Does
Professional,
it bother you?
Right?
Maybe, but...
But get over it.
So
interview. Right. Interview your advisor. Think of you are interviewing them for a job, even though you're not actually... A lot of people think they're going to be paying their advisor. I know it works differently at banks and credit unions and different kind of companies. How does it work at Meridian?
We don't charge for doing plans. And most places that you go to would not charge for a plan. Mm-hmm. We benefit from you being our members. That's how we get paid, for you just being our members.
Yeah, I don't think they put that out a lot, because a lot of people think, I know my mom did. She thought, well, if I go and see that, I'm going to get a bill. I'm going to get, you know, that. But it is a service that you provide.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Otherwise, we're just selling product, and that's not our goal. Mm-hmm. Our goal is to put together a plan to make you successful and to be part of that process with you.
Mm-hmm.
And we are held accountable. It's our report card for our members to ensure that they're successful. We don't just put a plan together in place and then say, good luck. We're kind of hand-holding you along the way, so you're not on your own, because it could be very daunting to do that.
Mm-hmm. I think people need to remember, this is sort of equivalent to interviewing your doctor. If you don't connect with your doctor, your GP, you're not going to be comfortable going. You're not going to open up about issues that you're having. And it's the same thing.
I was thinking that on the way here, actually. I was
financial health, physical health.
I was thinking dentist, because who likes to go to the dentist? We all love to leave once we've gone, but very few people say, I love getting my teeth cleaned. And personal finance is the same way. You have to be comfortable. But it is a process that could be very, not a lot of women are confident in how their personal situation looks like today. And having a plan provides that confidence. So it's so rewarding to go through that process, and having somebody that's a buddy with you along that process with you. And you know you're doing a good job when your client calls you and says, I'm thinking of a career change, Nancy, or... oh my goodness, we had to move my husband's mother into the house, and I'm not sure how this is going to affect our budget, but she's not financially comfortable. And if they're running these kinds of decisions by you, then you know you've got that trusted advisor kind of in your back pocket you're in that with her during the journey.
So how do people, Nancie, how do people connect to find an advisor?
You can look online on our website.
Yep.
We have all the advisors and their bios and their photos attached to every community that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
You can just walk into a branch and discuss it with somebody. And most of the advisors are mobile, so we can meet offsite. We can meet their place of work.
And I think the bios will indicate as well, too. You can check them out. You can read their bios. And we always have something quirky on each advisor just to make it more personal. So if Nancy can quickly share, what's your quirkiness on your bio?
Mine was around honesty, because I believe that's a trait that is important in an advisor. And when I was in grade 12 in high school, I was a big basketball player, and we were at a home game, and I scored the ball in the wrong basket. And if that wasn't embarrassing enough, I actually went on to cheer by myself. And then I realized what I had done. So.
And that's online.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for coming in and giving us a good laugh, Nancy.
Anytime.
Thanks so much.